হিজিবিল হ্যালো অন হয়ে গেছে। আচ্ছা আচ্ছা, লেট মি স্টার্ট। My friends, let me start today. Yes. Today's subject will be what I have told to clarify my two poems. One is the politics of the Gandhi Nehru dynasty. In the last many decades, from the days of Gandhi, has not changed. The main purpose of this Gandhi Nehru dynasty is to grab power, political power, in this form or that form. And if when there is crisis of their existence, to grab power, they will use divisive forces, even anti-national forces, even enemies of the country. That practice till now continues. I will discuss. Before that, the other point which I told you, that point to be clear, that the central characters of the political parties which were active in British India are active still today. The core characters has not changed, only some minor changes, and those political forces are in different forms today. You see, in British stage, the political theatre was dominated by four forces. The mightiest one, the British itself. Second was in the Congress, whose say characters majority was British agents. I have cleared that whenever there is some nationalist character, they have been eliminated. And number three is the Muslim League. Number four is the communists. Yet the forces, all these forces still today active in Indian politics today, in 2021. Maybe strength of some political forces has decreased, some has increased. But they are still in different forms. And British era, the nationalist force was a weaker force. Whenever the nationalist force tried to come up in the theatre, they have been killed, they have been sidelined, they have been cornered, encircled. Still today, the same characters is there. Characters today, you see, today the nationalist force, which was very weak in the British age, today gained some power, but the other forces are in different forms. Congress is there, led by the same Gandhi Nehru dynasty. Communists are there in different forms. Muslim League is there. Remember, after partition, the supporters of Pakistan did not go to Pakistan. They all stayed here in India. They only enter into different political parties. Congress, Communist Party, Socialist Party, all these. And different secular parties. And as the purpose of the Muslim League is being executed by these parties like Congress, secular parties, communists, there is no need of a separate existence of the Muslim League here. But still, the Muslim League elements is very active. Some are in indirect way, camouflaged, some are directly. And you see all the forces which were against the nationalist force, British Dutch, are still with, though in front they are in fighting, they are in close collaboration behind the curtain to oppose the nationalist forces. I mean nationalist force, I mean the force which want to build up new Bharatvarsha on some principles, on some foundations. And that foundation is India's history and heritage. And imbibing all modernities from all over the world. All modern knowledge, modern sciences, everything. And you see, the anti-national forces, anti-nationalist forces, the forces against the nationalist forces was very active in 30s, in 40s, and during partition, they remained active. And these forces against the nationalist forces, their main technique of ruling and winning votes is divide and rule. British days, the British policy was divide the country and rule the country. Divide and rule was the main policy. The main policy of the Congress today and the all secular parties, even Communist parties here in India today, in last 70 years you see, divide and rule. Divide and rule. They will not respect India's history and heritage. They have the segments of their voters. None of these political parties, including Congress, had ever an All India policy. An All India policy of reconstruction of this Bharatvarsha. I point to the history. You'll be in 39, when Subhash Chandra was elected Congress president, first elected Congress president, the tussle with Gandhi arose. And for this tussle, Subhash Chandra, to solve this tussle, Subhash Chandra wrote many letters to Gandhi, clearly asking him question, what are the areas of the tussle? Is it personal allergy or some principle? And you will see that no specific response. One day, I will talk to you on the correspondence between Subhash Chandra and Gandhi of 1939. I will clearly show you that different questions were raised by Subhash Chandra, but no specific answer from Gandhi. What is the reasons of his non-satisfaction with Subhash Chandra? Why there is Pond resolution? Why he is opposing Subhash Chandra? No clear-cut answer you will get. I will discuss where is his allergy? Where is his fear? Fear is, he is seeing an alternative All India Very dynamic leadership is coming. Number two, and that leadership is challenging the very authority of Gandhi. The Gandhian policy has little base, has little acceptance and utility in this modern world. And the planning committee and planning commission created by Subhash Chandra is the root cause of allergy of Gandhi to Subhash Chandra. Because for this planning committee and planning commission, the support has come from Sir Visveshwaraya, Acharya P.C. Rai, Meghnath Saha, Kobi Guru, and the lots of intellectuals, scientists, scholars who think seriously about the reconstruction of Bharatvarsha. I have told you very clearly that the main agenda of Gandhi was never the freedom of Bharatvarsha, never. Was not on the top of the list, in his priority list. In his priority list, topmost position is to preach his own ideology, doctrine, Gandhism. And always in his actions you will see, yes, his movements gone to an extent, but never beyond that, where the interest of British is hampered. And all his movements to energize Islamic fundamentalism, Islamic extremism. And never he has rebuked any murder by the Islamic extremists. Never. And his main purpose of non-violence was to preach this non-violence to Hindus only. Never he dared to preach non-violence to Muslim brothers. His non-cooperation movement main purpose was to energize Khilafat movement. And now come to end the killing of Tilak and then Lajpat Rai and then mysterious death of Deshbandhu created a space where British could manipulate positioning Gandhi, bringing him from South Africa. That I have discussed, I again discussed in a different chapter. You see, 39 crisis. 39 crisis, you see, in a correspondence, Subhash Chandra is asking, why he is not satisfied? Where is his discontent? If he wants really to guide the government, guide the country, guide the Congress, why not Gandhi is taking the primary membership of the Congress, giving Charana the Congress fund and directly coming to Congress platform to lead the Congress, to lead the nation? No answer. He is asking, up to 38 in the Congress working committees, always there is representation of different segments of the Congress. What has happened in between 1938? In 1938 Congress, Subhash Chandra was the Congress president, and in 1939 Subhash Chandra Congress president, and by election. Here you see, what has happened? What has changed? What has changed? Now the Congress Panth resolution is demanding a Congress working committee of 14 persons, all must be loyal to Gandhi. All must be of Gandhi's choice. And Congress, they demand all along, they are all inclusive party. Gandhi is Democrat. He needs consensus, he loves consensus. He tolerates everyone. But you see, he is insisting. Up a working committee of similar, all members having similar mentality, all should be loyal to Gandhi. As if a person not loyal to Gandhi, not favorite of Gandhi, cannot do good for the country. Anyone who wants to do good for the country as per Gandhi and Gandhians must be loyal to Gandhi. That is, this is the mentality of Gandhi Nehru dynasty today. And this time you see Gandhi and his Gandhian, and even Subhash Chandra is asking later, does he approve Ponce resolution? No answer. He is telling, in crisis, in modern countries like France and England, always in crisis, they form coalition governments composed of representatives of different political parties, who in peacetime fight with each other, but in crisis form coalition. Subhash Chandra is asking Gandhi, in our national crisis, why not the members represent different ideologies inside the Congress will be represented in the Congress working committee? No answer from Gandhi. And specific question he is asking, what is his cause of discontent? And Gandhi in his letter is telling there is an air of mistrust, air of violence. That's why he has suspended all movements in India. Then Subhash Chandra is asking in 39, then why, when I am wanting to meet you when I am very sick, I want to meet you. You came to Delhi to meet the Governor General. I wanted to meet you, though I was very sick. But you left Gandhi, you left Delhi to Rajkot. Rajkot is a very small princely state. There is some very minor problem. And you went to Rajkot to solve their problem. And you started there your Anoshan, starvation and movements. And the whole country in the British India, where we are for last 40 years, the Congress movement is there, people is strained for the movements. There you are telling the country is not prepared for the movements. But in Rajkot, the princely state, where the people is not habituated to any movement, not trained for movement, and you have gone there, started starvation there, and then your national issue is not a priority today, but a minor issue in Rajkot is priority. No answer. Because you see, Gandhi himself, to keep his power under his own grip, is now dividing Congress, a divisive politics. He is not wanting any socialist member or any other group member to represent in Congress working committee. He is demanding only the Congress leaders who is loyal to him. That is Ponce resolution. And in one letter, Subhash Chandra is asking Gandhi, do your loyals asked permission from you about the Ponce resolution? He is telling, no, I do not know. Can you imagine? The world knows it is under Gandhi's guidance from a distance. Ponce resolution was passed to corner Subhash Chandra. And Gandhi himself, when asked, he is playing innocence. This is Gandhi. Take similarly, still today you see in the Congress politics, Gandhi Nehru dynasty is behind. They are not directly.
in Sonia Gandhi, you see. And you see, Gandhi was telling all these things whenever he is asked for some reasons of his actions. He will give no reasons. Only he will tell, this is his inner voice. And you, I have told you, this inner voice is nothing but the intelligence input from British intelligence. And similarly, Sonia Gandhi, whenever asked any questions, there is no reasoning. He is telling, my inner voice, my inner divine voice, the same play is there. And though today Congress is very weak, but other political parties, secular parties, they are playing the game of Congress, divide and rule policy. No political party has any All India policy for reconstruction of the whole of Bharatvarsha. No political party has got any All India policy, All India planning, no party. They all think of their own political parties, own families and groups. And all these political parties you see today who are opposing the nationalist party, the only nationalist party of India, all are family based parties, all are family properties. When a party is a family property, how can it be democratic? And they claim democracy in this country. That is the paradox. I am next I will address the popular perceptions throughout the country, that historians and these scholars, that Gandhi Nehru has no role in taking direct action by Jinnah in 1946. They always tell that Jinnah is a bad man, he wanted Pakistan. He called direct action and killing thousands in Calcutta, thousands in Noakhali and different parts, which that situation increased the value of the two nation theory. And that sealed the fate of Bharatvarsha, which led to the partition of India. Before that, I tell you, if you tell the partition of India, the most important for the partition of India, the energizing the Muslim fundamentalists. First is Muslim League formation in 1906 in Shahbag Park in Dhaka. The money given by the governor of Bengal and the Nawab of Dhaka. That means the Muslim League was formation financed by British governor of Bengal and Nawab of Dhaka. Then they further energized the Islamic fundamentalist movement by Gandhi, by Khilafat movement. And then step by step Jinnah. But behind this direct action, is it Jinnah only responsible, or there is some role of Gandhi Nehru? I tell you one thing. Remember, all these are British agents. Either your Congress, these elements, Gandhi Nehru, and this Muslim League, and these communists, all are British agents. And they are controlled from behind by the British. And we the countrymen are seeing in front that these political parties are fighting for the country, though they have got different beliefs, different faiths, different techniques, and different way of serving the country. That's why apparently they are fighting in front, but no, they are well coordinating behind the curtain to having a common agenda. The common agenda is to preserve the British interest in the Indian subcontinent, to coordinate so that nationalist force
do not come to power. And if British is compelled to leave this country, so that British can peacefully divide this country and hand over the powers to the to these groups who are hankering after power, and retreat from this, preserving the economic interest in this subcontinent, and practically by partition, by giving consent to partition, first demand no doubt by Jinnah, and first support by, remember, first Jinnah's demands, then by the Rajagopalachari, then, remember, Communist Party of India, then Congress AICC, the step by step approval. Anyway, I am coming to that crisis. Remember, the world knows Gandhi supported in the 11th hour. No, this is absolutely wrong. I am showing you a document. The document is Selected Speeches of Subhash Chandra Bose by Publication Division, 1962, Government of India. In this, I am quoting one speech, radio speech by Subhash Chandra from Burma, September 12, 1944. Please note, this is the publication of Government of India, and the speech headline is Warning Against Partition. You see here, friends and my countrymen, I want to talk to you today about the Indian situation. You are all aware that Gandhi and Jinnah are discussing Hindu-Muslim question in Bombay, and that Gandhiji is prepared to come to an agreement with the League, even if it means conceding League demand of Pakistan. See, 1944 September, Subhash Chandra has collected news that Gandhi has already agreed to the Pakistan demand of Jinnah. And whatever Gandhi is telling is just a drama. And telling, I do not want partition. If there is a partition, it must be on my dead body. Such dramabaji is there, continuous. But real, I have told you, real hidden agenda of Gandhi is to make Nehru the prime minister of this, a huge part of this country, maybe minusing different parts of this country, maybe conceding Pakistan to Jinnah, all these things. And I'll show you, even Nehru, when he's seeing that in British will go, particularly when he's seeing that after the INA trial, a nationalist movement has, very strong nationalist movement in India, and British has decided to leave this country under the situation compulsion. Nehru is afraid that let this country come to his hand, but he is hesitating. He is telling how he will tackle, control the tribal areas in the west of India, bordering Afghanistan. And his apprehension, his talks are recorded by no one but the ADC of Mountbatten, that is Narendra Singh Saida, ADC, in his book, The Shadow of Great Gain, The Untold Story of India's Partition. Think. And you see, I have told you, when country is partitioned, one part has gone to Nehru, he's a Muslim, crypto-Muslim. Other part has gone to Jinnah, a Muslim, and the Kashmir has gone to
gone to Abdullah, the biological brother of Nehru. Practically, the British got India from the Mughals, Muslims, and practically the country is handed over to Muslims. And that point I want to clear. You are all blaming Jinnah for direct action. No, my brother, there is a positive role, active role of Nehru. I am coming to that point. That point, yes. You see, how much time is there? Are you tired? Oh, no, not much time. Oh, just 30 minutes. Oh, let me stop here. 1946-47 picture. You see? INA trial, 1945, November, Red Fort trial. And on this issue, throughout whole India, a nationalist movement has started to free the INA soldiers. And in British Indian history of last 190 years, never there was movement of this magnitude, not even in 1857 during Sipahi Mutiny, and never during any Gandhi movements by Congress, never. Unprecedented, massive movement, and that compelled to free the imprisoned INA soldiers. Though secretly they killed many INA soldiers in Indian prisons and also in different parts of Southeast Asia. That was beyond our knowledge. That did not come to notice of the people of this country. And you see, and Nehru, Gandhi, all these persons, seeing the popularity of the INA, they all started praising INA and Subhas Bose, because the British noticed it, the transfer of power. The political leaders who think of their political future, who has aspirations, cannot stand away from these popular movements. They entered and they got them popularized and subsequently stabbed. Gandhi did it, Nehru did it all. And Nehru, for the first time of his life, put on the barrister's gown, whole life, and to get popularity, only popularity. And you see, in 46 April, Nehru has gone to Singapore. Why? Who called him? Congress is telling that they sent Nehru to Southeast Asia, including Singapore, to look after the INA soldiers there. And that is the show in the service. The real aim of Nehru was three. And the arrangement was made by the royal family in England. Remember, Mountbatten himself, the royal family member. And royal family first requested the governor of Burma to invite Nehru. But the governor rejected that. And then they told Mountbatten to invite Nehru. And Mountbatten arranged everything. And there what happened? Number one, he got it confirmed that Subhas Chandra Bose has not died in the plane crash. That confirmation, number one. Number two, his equations, because already it is settled that Wavell will be taken back to London, Mountbatten will be taken as Governor General with a task of partition and transfer of power. And naturally, Nehru is there to settle the things. Number three, personal relations build up between Mountbatten and Edwina Nehru.
and other thing is the sharing of the INA treasures, sharing of the INA treasures. And you see, then he came back. You see here, when and in this situation of the nationalist fervor, British show, Muslim League show, Congress show, it is very difficult to partition India. Partition India. Because Hindus are not wanting partition. Muslims are not wanting partition. Because if there is a partition, Muslims of Bihar, Central India, UP, all has to go to Pakistan. They lose their homes, lose their property. Even the, though they are in voice, they are demanding Pakistan, but in the mind, they are always all afraid. And demand for Pakistan is not that strong in Sindh, in Balochistan, and in Northwest Frontier Province. And sale of the two-nation theory, sale of the dream of Pakistan is not high. In that situation, a technique is generated. How to increase the sale of this two-nation theory? How to make it popular? And you see, here all characters are working. You see, come here. 24th March, cabinet mission led by Sir Patrick Lawrence came to Delhi. He proposed there, when he is saying that there is no popular sale of the theory of partition of India, he could not utter partition of India. He proposed transfer of power of undivided India with groupings, a federation, groupings, three groupings, A, B, C. A group of states, Hindu majority states. B, a group of states, Muslim majority states. And C, Assam and Bengal. And two central powers will be with the central government. That is foreign policy and currency, all these things. And all agreed. Nehru, Congress agreed. Another option. Muslim League agreed. Jinnah agreed. Because no other option. Because there is the two-nation theory still now yet to be is not popular at that time. Now you see. Now it was settled and newly elected president after this settlement, consensus, on 10th July 1946 in Delhi, newly appointed Congress President Nehru. Nehru was already three times Congress President, again Congress President. Gandhi's choice. He made a press conference. What he told? We'll run the government by majority. We'll run the government by majority. That means we'll not run the government by consensus. And he told that whatever the cabinet mission has told, but we will act as per the majority. By majority, we'll change the policies. And that disrupted the whole issue. Whole situation that angered Jinnah, and Jinnah was waiting for such an issue, sensitive statement, and Nehru gave that opportunity to Jinnah, and Jinnah now came out from all agreements. He called his working committee of the Muslim League. There he took the decision of direct action. And you know what is direct action. Started in Calcutta in 16th August 1946. The Islamic terrorists killing Hindus, then automatically reactions. Once there is a killing started,
then subsequently none will see who is Hindu, who is Muslim. And then in Noakhali, lakhs of our mothers are raped by the Muslim terrorists, thousands are killed. Then in Bihar, you see, when in Calcutta, under the Muslim League government, this was going on. Interim government is there in Delhi. Prime Minister in is Nehru. Nehru remained silent, told nothing. But the moment Bihar reacted, Nehru's sleep was broken. He was awakened. Because in Bihar, the Bihari Hindu community was retaliating. And then he shouted. Then Nehru shouted, roared, that I will bomb these Bihar villages by Air Force bombing. And you see, when the Hindus were being killed in Calcutta and Noakhali, Nehru was sleeping, told nothing. Similarly, it is Gandhi was sleeping when Hindus were killed by the Khilafatists in Kerala, in so-called Mopla revolution. And you see, in last 70 years, even whenever, wherever Hindus are killed, in Kashmir or any village in India, in Bangladesh or in Pakistan, Gandhi dynasty sleeps. Congress cannot see, selectively blind. And all secularists in India, selectively blind. Same behavior. And you see, I'll stop here by quoting, and actually Nehru helped Jinnah to adopt. Nehru was not that stupid that his statement is very sensitive, will be sensitive. He was in politics for 40 years. He's not that stupid. He deliberately provoked Jinnah so that Jinnah comes out from this consensus, and so that whole plan of transfer of power of the undivided India is disrupted. And Nehru did it very, very intelligently, very cunningly. And I will quote from two very popular books. How dangerous, how sensitive, how destructive the statement of Nehru. Because Nehru's statement sealed the fate of Bharatvarsha, sealed the fate of the dream of undivided India. And I am saying, on 10th July, I am first quoting from India Wins Freedom by Maulana Abul Kalam Azad. And in this volume, there is many, many statements which has exposed Nehru. But still, you will be astonished, this book is dedicated to Nehru. And many of the misdeeds of Nehru Gandhis, these Gandhians, the loyal, this has not exposed. These are the minimum things they have written in their volumes. These are minimum things. I'm quoting. The chapter is Prelude to Partition. On 10th July, Jawaharlal held a press conference in Bombay, in which he made a statement which in normal circumstances might have been placed almost unnoticed, but in the existing atmosphere of suspicion and hatred, set in train a most unfortunate series of consequences. Some press representatives asked him whether, with the passing of the resolution of AICC, the Congress had accepted the plan in toto, including composition of the interim government. Jawaharlal stated in reply that Congress would enter the Constituent Assembly completely unfettered by agreements and free to meet all situations as they arise. Press representatives further asked if this meant that the cabinet mission plan could be modified Jawaharlal replied emphatically that the Congress had agreed only to participate in the Constituent Assembly and regarded itself free to change or modify the cabinet mission plan as it thought best. I must place on record that Jawaharlal's statement was wrong. It was not correct to say that Congress was free to modify the plan as it pleased. We had in fact agreed that the central government would be federal. There would be a compulsory list of three central subjects while all other subjects remained in the provincial sphere. We had further agreed that there would be the three sections A, B, C I have discussed, and Jawaharlal's statements came to him as a bombshell. That is, I request all of you, I think this book is available maybe in collection of many of you, I'll request you to read this, how Nehru's statement disrupted the consensus of transfer of power of undivided India. Then I will quote another volume of, again that volume is dedicated to Nehru, written by the friend of Nehru, famous volume, Leonard Mosley, The Last Days of British. পরে কথা বলে আধ ঘন্টা পরে লেনার্ড মোসলে আই এম দি লেনার্ড মোসলে পেজ নাম্বার 21 দি ফর্চুনস অফ ইন্ডিয়া ওয়ার ইন ব্যালেন্স অ্যান্ড ওয়ান ফলস মুভ কুড আপসেট দেম নেহরুজ ক্লোজ চুজ দ্য মোমেন্ট to launch into what his biographer Michael Brecher has described as one of the most fiery and provocative statements in his 40 years of public life. Most provocative. And sealed the fate of transfer of power of undivided India. And also, in one place, Maulana Azad has written, Jawaharlal's mistake in 1937 had been bad enough. The mistake of 46 proved even most costly. And the Jinnah statement was before the direct action is, now there is no room left for compromise. Let us march on. Never have we in the whole history of the League done anything except by constitutional methods. But now we are forced into this position, the day we bid goodbye to constitutional method. Now direct action. Killing the Hindus by swords. Naturally, after this direct action, Hindus started telling that enough is enough. Enough is enough. Now let us our own land, let us have our own land, let the Muslims get their own. Muslims also started telling, let us have our own land, Pakistan, the holy land, Pakistan. This is a good coordination. I tell you, even today, I tell you, the divisive politics of Gandhi Nehru dynasty to grab powers, to keep themselves in power, always divisive politics, and all the Gandhians in different political parties, all the seculars who has taken birth by fragmentation of the Congress, all these political parties who are practically all family parties in this country, are their main, you will see their common characteristics. None of these political parties believe in the historicity of the Ramayana Mahabharata. None will believe that India has got a past. very glory in science, wisdom, all these things. And they will all maintain that policy, British policy of divide and rule. All has got a particular vote bank, divisive politics. None think of the country as a whole, none. And all were one very affluent in 1930s, 38, 39 and 40, 46. About a man who was leading the nationalist forces. And all these forces was very afraid that this man come to power. This man re-enters India. The man reappears in all. The history is this. Communists and socialists did not support Subhash Bose in 1939 and up to 46. All had cheated, stabbed nationalism. All. None think of the country as a whole. None has got any project of rebuilding this Bharatvarsha. And now today, when a party has taken what from the soil of this Bharatvarsha and standing on the history and heritage of this Bharatvarsha, stand to rebuild this Bharatvarsha, imbibing all modernities, all resources from all over the world, all these political parties against that. And they are forming a common front against the nationalist forces. They did it in 1939, 45, 46, and for the transfer of power, during transfer of power. They directly or indirectly all helped the British plan of partition of India. That's the tragedy. That's why I have told you. The central core characters has not changed. Only thing, the nationalist force, for the first time in last 100 years, actually our country is not in bondage for more than 1,000 years, in bondage. And for that, we are yet to regain our moral consciousness, intellectual consciousness, or intellectual liberty, moral liberty. We are still in moral bondage. We are still in colonial hangover. We cannot think what is really good for us. And when we are awakening, the enemies, they are forming a common front. What they did in 39 to corner Subhash Chandra Bose and also join together behind the curtain to oppose the appearance of the ghost in Bharatvarsha, and their activity helped British to partition India and to transfer. Let me stop here today. I think 55 minutes. Let me stop here today. I cannot see your comments today. Can I see your comments today? I do not cannot. I cannot see your comments today. Please, I cannot see your comments today because my small set is recording my talk for the YouTube, and here I cannot say because I am confined to today in the laptop. I failed to make the desktop functional. Please keep your questions. I will try to answer in subsequent day. This I have recorded in English only because some of the friends for last 1 year
I have not done any talk in English. They're demanding that. And if some questions, I'll try to answer. One day I will talk. Last for 30 years, I am telling one thing, that there is a big role of Nehru, Mountbatten, Edwinan behind framing the false story of marriage. All methods in false story, manufacturing. And subsequently I am concluded that Omiya Ghosh is also a criminal character. But there is Mountbatten. Are you seeing the discussions in Parliament of England and debates in their courts in England on the issue whether to release and publish Mountbatten papers? Yes, there is some mystery, some clue why Mountbatten and Nehru collaborated, taking the help of Omiya Ghosh. And some sections, other Ghosh groups, to manufacture the false story of marriage. And also one day I will discuss the Gandhi Nehru correspondences. And we do not know still today how much Gandhi is cunning, how much Nehru is cunning. Even I tell you, Abul Kalam Azad, or Leonard Mosley, or all these persons, whatever they have written very minimum, without that a book writing is not possible. But behind that, beyond that, there are many more crimes. They are recently being written or exposed in other volumes. If you read that, you can see their cunningness, their ugliness, their criminality. It's much deeper than what we think. And these same crimes are inherited by the present day political parties, present day family centric political parties in India. You see, except one political party, all political parties here in India are familyist, dictatorial. All divisive forces. Let me stop here today.